on today's season preview, part 6.
Trick love the kids, and so do we. We make our picks for this year's NBA Rookie of the Year.
Is this LeBron's final year in Cleveland? Do fire and ice finish the year in New Orleans? Will Dwight repair his rep in Charlotte?
And in Crossfire, Tass and Lee debate which star will lead the league in scoring.
The Starters' 82 Burning Questions starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to part 6 of the Starters NBA season preview. Shout out to everyone joining us live right now on NBA TV or a little bit later on YouTube. Very happy to have you. I'm Jay Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Mellis.
Welcome to preview 6 of 9.
To his right, the international man of mystery, taking it to the max, Lee Ellis.
Friend.
Lee! And last, certainly not least, down yonder, it is the bearded one, it's Trey Kirby.
Hey-o!
All right, we're continuing to answer 82 burning questions about the upcoming NBA season, which is now 1 week away. How many days is that, Lee?
7.
There it is. Way to go, Lee.
Nice.
All right, so we've got 9 more questions to tackle this evening. As we've asked you throughout these season preview shows, play along on Twitter. Jump on Twitter using the hashtag #TheStarters with your answers. Here we go. Question 46 overall. It's another award question. Who wins Rookie of the Year? I think this is a tough question.
I'll start us off. I'm going off the board. I'm not picking a kid. I'm picking an old man, a 30-year-old man by the name of Miloš Teodosić. Now,
wow.
I might be getting a little too excited. Maybe I'm just trying to confirm my bias of watching this guy for the last 10 years in the EuroLeague, being very pumped to watch him play. But I've been very pumped to watch him play this preseason. He's been dropping crazy dimes. Now, this pick might blow up in my face because he may not even play a ton on his team. Mm-hmm. But I think at some point, Doc Rivers is going to have to say, we need some playmaking without Chris Paul there. The other guards of Austin Rivers, Patrick Beverley, Lou Williams aren't playmakers like Miloš. Now, he may not even score a ton, but look at these dimes, folks.
The dimes
you
got
to score,
crazy.
Though. You usually got to score to win Rookie of the Year.
That's a problem. Yeah, that's a problem with Miloš, but he can shoot the ball. He shot an above percentage, yep. a three-point percentage in Europe, and obviously this is a deeper three. And I'm just trying to convince myself, but I'm
like
just pumped to watch this guy play. Let's go with Miloš.
We're all excited to have him in the league.
Of course. Yeah, he's 30. He's not old by any means, but if you're picking a guy with a beard for Rookie of the Year, you're kind of cheating.
Yeah, I remember doing EuroLeague shows with you like 7 or 8 years
right.
ago, and we were like, this guy's a stud. He should be in the NBA. Mm-hmm. This is when he was young, 22, mm-hmm. 23 years mm-hmm. old. We were hoping, oh, maybe he'll make the move over to the NBA. He finally does. We're happy about that, but... That's quite the pick
with this
loaded draft rookie class.
Sure,
too.
And he might not even start.
And he may not start.
I imagine he's going to finish games. I imagine he's going to play a lot because I don't think he's going to give Doc much of a choice.
Okay, we got Miloš, which is a great name.
Yeah.
Anyone else?
Well, I'm kind of going off the board as well because he's not really a rookie. He's in his second year, but he's eligible because he didn't play in his first year. It's Ben Simmons from the Philadelphia 76ers. I think the main reason is he's going to have the ball in his hand a lot at the start, especially even over his fellow rookie Markel Fultz. Now, talking about a guy who can't shoot, that's definitely Ben Simmons' weakness, but he can get to the rim. He's got incredible athleticism. He knows how to get inside. He can finish with either hand. And I think
he doesn't really finish a lot with the left. He shoots with the left,
yeah.
but he finishes with the right.
But even in the preseason so far, the penetration is
what I like
to see there. And also, he's going to fill up the box score. He's going to get rebounds and assists. And again, the shooting.
He'll score in transition.
Yeah, and look, which rookie goes out there and shoots really well? Hardly any of them. You think of like Chris Paul, Tony Parker, Derrick Rose, all those guys as rookies. Awful shooters, they learn. I think Ben Simmons, even that year on the bench as well, even though he didn't play, you learn a ton.
Oh, we've seen that before with Joel Embiid. Mm-hmm. I mean, he missed a couple of years, of course, and then looked great in his 31 games. Blake Griffin.
For sure.
He missed an entire season. You know, he comes back, has a bit of a leg up, I think. Just being on the bench, being with the training staff.
Exactly.
Knowing the playbook a little bit more, the scheme, the way you're running, the style, the system. It worked for him. I'm with you. I'm going Ben Simmons as well. And he's going to be the facilitator on a team that a lot of people think might make the playoffs, which... helps. I mean, we saw Brogdon win it last year because he was contributing to a team that was making some noise into the playoff race in the East. So I'm with you on the Ben Simmons pick.
Yeah, does he score enough? I think that's a fair question. He's got a really unique skill set, and it's going to come along. He might be the best player of this draft. I guess it's not this draft. in a few years from now, call it this class. But I don't know if he's going to score enough this year.
Trey, you taking anyone from this actual draft class?
Yeah, I'm taking a guy actually drafted this year. I'm a Lonzo Ball-iever. I think that him and Ben Simmons are in similar boats. They're both playing for really hyped up, buzzy teams. They're going to have tons of highlights. They're going to have a ton of opportunity just having the ball in their hands, like you were saying with Ben Simmons. They both are going to have trouble scoring and shooting a little bit, but they're great passers. And if either of their teams improve, they're going to get a lot of the credit for it. You're already seeing it with Lonzo, with Luke Walton saying, we got to play faster, we got to move the ball, we got to give him chances to make plays. I think he's going to be a little bit better scorer than Ben Simmons, just because I think he is used to playing without being able to score, kind of, if that makes any sense. Whereas Ben Simmons can kind of like overwhelm people with his athleticism. But I just think that those two are the most realistic candidates going into the season, and I'm personally more Lonzo than Simmons right now.
You go up and down the list, though, of this rookie class. You can, like, talk yourself into a lot of these guys for rookie of the year. I mean, Dennis Smith with the Mavericks.
If he wasn't playing for Rick Carlisle, he would be much
better. I think Rick Carlisle is completely fine going to play him 30, 35 minutes. I absolutely think so.
From the start, you think
so? I think so.
And, he's starting.
And him, he's the type of guy, like, he's going to be on our top 10 list, I'd imagine, a number of times. He's going to have those poster dunks. He's going to have those chase down blocks, maybe a game winner or two. That stuff, you know, sticks with people, right? You notice those performances. So you can talk yourself into him.
And I think it's pretty easy to talk yourself into him.
Because absolutely.
They're going to spread the floor with Dirk at the five spot. Watching them play last night, there's no one touching the paint. And with an athletic guy like Dennis Smith, he can get to the lane whenever he wants. There's going to be a lot of space.
De'Aaron Fox with the Kings. You know, he just had a little bit of an injury in preseason. Hopefully it's nothing too serious. But him, a guy impacting on both ends of the floor with his defense. Jason Tatum with the Celtics. Maybe he is an instrumental part of that Celtics bench. And that team wins, you know, 55 games. And people are like, oh, okay. You can talk yourself into many, many guys here. Donovan Mitchell with the Jazz and so on.
I'm looking forward to Fox and Lonzo Ball when they first match up, because we know that Lonzo's been accused of perhaps avoiding him in Summer League and preseason as well. So I can't wait for that first
match. Can't dodge him forever.
No, exactly.
Can't dodge him. All right, so again, let's refresh your memory here of who we're taking for our official.
That guy's a rookie with that beard.
Yeah, wow. That guy is a rookie. Trey's going with Lonzo Ball. Lee and I are going with Ben Simmons, and Taz going with Milos Teodosic. Let's hear your rookie of the year predictions. Like I said, jump on Twitter, hashtag the starters. All right, our next question, also a good one here. Guys, what was the offseason's best under-the-radar move? What do you have?
To me, it's Jay Crowder, because LeBron James finally has a guy who will take the best offensive player on the other team. And if you can make the best player in the league happy, that's a fantastic thing. I don't know if Jay Crowder is going to convince LeBron to stay in Cleveland, but LeBron hasn't had a guy like this since Shane Battier in Miami, literally since he came to Cleveland in 2014. Now he can play center field.
Sure.
We know LeBron can play other sports. He's going to play a little baseball. He can go. He can hang out, and maybe he can go after that Defensive Player of the Year trophy that he's always wanted.
Wow.
I don't think he's necessarily going to get it, but he's always wanted to put that on the mantelpiece along with those four MVPs. I think Jay Crowder obviously was the second biggest piece in that trade alongside Isaiah Thomas to go to Cleveland. It's going to make LeBron really happy.
That would be ironic if LeBron won Defensive Player of the Year when you just said Crowder would be taking usually the best offensive wing guy on the other team.
I'd freelance
possible.
A little bit. I'm going with J.J. Redick, actually, from the Sixers. 1 year, $23 million deal. Reason I like him there, veteran presence. And we talked about Ben Simmons in the previous summer league and people saying all these great passes and this great court vision doesn't help if you haven't got guys who can knock down shots. We know J.J. Redick is one of the best shooters in the league, so he's going to be running to his spots. Simmons can be cutting inside, causing penetration, dishing it out to a guy like J.J. Redick. He's one of the most underrated players I think we've seen for a while, because you know what J.J. Redick can do. He can hit those shots, he can get inside, and he's a great team player as well. So I think this is a very smart move by the Sixers.
And he's a grown-up. I think that's huge.
You didn't blink at all when you saw that 1 year, $23 million for J.J. Redick?
I mean, it's fine. If they're going to pay him, why not? I mean,
everybody else is on rookie contracts. They've got money to go around. Yeah. So J.J., I think, is a perfect fit for them on the court and off the court. Another guy I feel the same way is kind of P.J. Tucker. The Rockets last year really flamed out in the playoffs. People were all over them with their personalities and the way they kind of just handled themselves on the court. I think they just needed a guy who will help them play with a chip on their shoulder. That's what happened when he got to the Raptors last year. They became a defensive team again. Part of that was Serge Ibaka as well. But I think they just need a guy who's going to kind of be a jerk. And I think he'll get along with Chris Paul as well. They're going to be really annoying to play against. Yeah. And that's something different for the Rockets. They're going to be in your face on defense.
Yeah. The Thunder, to a lot of people, I think, won the offseason, maybe trading for Paul George, trading for Melo, but I like the Patrick Patterson signing. You know, little bit as an under-the-radar move. 3 years, $16.5 million. We saw him play for our Raptors. Mm-hmm. Pesky defender, can hit the three for a bigger guy. I think he's going to get some minutes there in that OKC lineup, so I like that move for OKC, and Presti knocking it out of the park, hopefully once again. All right, we got to take a break. Lots more still to come on the show tonight. When we return, is this LeBron's last season in Cleveland? You alluded to that there, Tass. We'll debate that and more in the Up-Down Report. Come on back. Bet back with the starters right into the up-down report. Four more questions of our 82 burning cues. Question 48 overall, guys. Is this LeBron's final year in Cleveland? This isn't even about the upcoming season, but the season after that.
Oh, it's always about LeBron.
Yeah. Ooh.
I think he hangs in one more.
One more.
Just one more, then makes a decision. Because he always wants to go to a good situation. LeBron always makes smart, smart decisions. So to me, it comes down to, are the Lakers going to be advanced? Are they going to be good enough? Why not just stay one more year in Cleveland, stay with his banana boat brother and Dwayne Wade for one more year, and then bounce to L.A. and go to a quick little finals in 2019 one more time because he wants to? The Lakers got to be good for him to go. And I think, you know, he might just want to wait one more year.
He's won the championship in Cleveland, so he can actually go now and people can't hate on him. He can do that if he wants. I honestly don't think he's definitely made up his mind right now. I think he's leaning towards leaving. Let's say they win the championship, though. Do you think he goes? I think he stays and tries to win back-to-back if that happens. So,
yeah, I don't think he would leave Cleveland after a championship. Personally, I've always been wrong. I never thought LeBron would leave Cleveland in the first place. I never thought he would leave Miami. Now I do think he's going to leave
Cleveland.
So he's definitely not going to leave. If you're putting money down, he's staying in Cleveland next year. But who knows? I think it's an open question now, like you're saying, heading into the season before everything happened with the Celtics trade. I would have thought LeBron for sure was going to LA probably next season, but now they've kind of extended their window a little bit. They've gotten a little bit younger with guys like Osman and Zizic. They got the pick from the Nets. They brought in Dwayne Wade, LeBron's friend. They brought in Isaiah Thomas. They're staying competitive. They've done what they can to make it still enticing for him even after this season.
It's assumed that it's the Lakers or nowhere else, though, isn't it? I mean, there's no other city. He's not going back to Miami. He's not going to Boston or somewhere like New York.
The thing about the Lakers, too, is that they have so much cap room because all those guys in Ingram, Ball, Randall, they're all really young. So he can go there and bring another max star with him.
Right.
You know, he can bring, you know, whether it's Paul George, of course, that's the name that comes up. But I think those guys have to advance for him to want to jump over there. And conspiracy theorists will say that he's played 7 years with the Cavs, 4 with the Heat, then 4 with the Cavs, then he's going to go to the Lakers for another 7.
Because
loves numbers.
Wow.
7, 4, 4, 7.
Okay,
yeah, yeah.
All right.
Circles. 22-year career.
Question 49. Question 49. This one coming from Mike Folletti on Twitter. Shout out to Mike. Will Cousins and Anthony Davis end the season in New Orleans? If you were a betting man, thumbs up or thumbs down?
Wow.
Wow. All three of you say they will be there come April, maybe into May.
I just don't think the Pelicans can get rid of DeMarcus Cousins and hope to keep Anthony Davis as his career progresses. They would have then traded 2 lottery picks and the guy they got back for those lottery picks. If they lost all those guys and they're trying to keep one of the best young stars in the game, that's just not the right message to send. So I don't really think there's any way they can lose their second best player and still say, hey, stay with us. Try and win a title here in New Orleans.
It's certainly going against the grain having 2 big guys right now, but these are floor spacing big guys and they can both put it on the floor. So it might work. But if it doesn't, if they get off to a slow start around the trade deadline just before the All-Star game, I wouldn't be surprised if the Pelicans are putting out some feelers, though, just to see what they can get in return, because they're going to have a fairly big window then to see if this experiment is going to work with these two. And if it's not, and if they're struggling to make the playoffs again, they might decide to cut
back. And get some return, maybe. Yeah.
I believe in skinny DeMarcus, and I believe in skinny DeMarcus going into a contract year. I think they're just going to be good, and I think they're going to save everyone's job. Now, Rajon Rondo being out kind of hurts because they're sort of weak around the perimeter, around those guys. You know, Drew Holiday and those.
What's he going to do on the perimeter, though?
Who, Rajon Rondo?
Yeah.
Handle the ball. I understand.
He's not shooting it.
They just need ball handlers.
That's absolutely right. Yeah, Rondo out 4 to 6 weeks by reports. All right, question number 50 here, guys. Do the Warriors have the league's best bench? Ooh. Okay. Yeah. Couple up. Trey down.
Yeah.
Who's got it? Who's got it then?
Well, if it's not the Warriors, I think it's got to be the Cavs. And I think that that's just not necessarily their bench as a whole, as a second unit, but they have a lot of guys who are going to be different looks to play next to LeBron. And that's really all that matters when you're a bench player with the Cavs. They got some shooters. They've got more creators than they have last year. They have a little bit more youth. They've got guys that LeBron likes playing with. Tristan Thompson moving to the bench. J.R. Smith, those guys have bought into coming off the bench. J.R., a former Sixth Man of the Year winner. I think we forget that now. They're better, their benches, than they were last season. And last season, they were kind of a disaster.
I don't like their defense on the bench, though. Calderon, Kyle Korver, Channing Frye. I mean, you've got to play some defense, don't you?
They didn't play any defense last year.
I know. That's where I just get a little bit concerned that maybe LeBron and the starters.
They got Jumper. They got Tristan Thompson.
They're okay. But again, the backcourt there, I mean, they're turnstiles, really, aren't
they? So the Warriors, so you get the edge of the Warriors, what, because of Iguodala?
Iguodala mainly. And then you look at guys like JaVale, who's been a laughing stock, but he's turned into a productive guy off the bench on both ends of the floor. He can change shots. He can block shots and he can catch dunks. They brought in Caspi this year. They brought in Swaggy P.
Lockdown unusual, defender.
unusual move, I'll admit that. But they did bring in Caspi as well. Just
Young and Caspi are perfect for their team.
Yeah.
For sure.
And we laugh at Nick Young's signing, but he's shooting above 40%.
Right.
He is going to plenty of space. I mean, that is exactly the type of guy that they zeroed in on, was Nick Young and Omri Caspi, because they shoot.
I think with this question, it's always
ridiculously great.
It's always like, do you, when you say, okay, who has the best bench, are you saying, well, who's got the five or six guys on the bench? Or is it really, like most NBA games, who are the three best guys on your bench?
And then
it's two different ways to tackle it, right? Because the Warriors with Iguodala and Livingston right there alone, those are some of the best sub guys in the league. And then whoever else you want to put in as your third guy there. They're stacked, but I also like your pick as well in the Cavs.
And again, we always overlook the Spurs because that's what we do. They had the best bench according to the numbers last year. They get Rudy Gay, who's coming off their bench, Patty Mills, Manu, guys that
And they play their bench the most.
Yeah, exactly. You know, the Lakers played their bench a ton last year, but they'll probably play their starters a little bit more.
All right, final one. We have to have this question because we have it every year. Will Dwight Howard save his reputation? Will he save his reputation by going now playing in Charlotte?
I guess not.
No, okay.
Oh, man. This might be our first three-way thumbs down in the entire preview. I'm a little bit more optimistic about Dwight than I was before the preseason. I like seeing him go coast to coast. There was always a rumor that he was a point guard in high school, and now I'm actually starting to believe it a little, but the guy hasn't changed this far in his career. I imagine he's going to be the same guy.
He's going to pout early on when things don't go his way. Cody Zeller was good for them last year, and they're going to need him. If Dwight is disciplined and does what he's asked to do by the Hornets, he could be productive again, but you know what he's like. He just doesn't like it when he's asked to do things that he doesn't like.
To give Dwight credit, he wasn't really a quote-unquote problem until the playoffs last year, right? Nobody
with the Hawks.
He wasn't really an issue.
He was complaining about touches before.
Steve Clifford is going to give
when
him.
He got traded.
So there was a problem for sure. Steve Clifford looks like he's going to give him touches.
Yeah, but why?
All right, Dwight. Coming up next, who will lead the league in scoring? Tass and Lee go head to head in a Crossfire rematch.
Oh, Lee's the better scorer for sure.
Crossfire. This is how it works. Referee Skeets will give Lee and me three topics. We'll debate each one. At the end of it all, Referee Skeets will declare a winner, and winner stays on during these previews.
That's right. Let's have a clean crossfire here, gentlemen. Question 52 overall in the first round. It's all about the buckets. Who's going to lead the league in scoring? Here we go.
This is the year of Kevin Durant. You and me have already both picked him already to win the MVP this year.
Yeah.
Part of the reason why, he's going to score a ton of points. Last year, he was happy just settling in. 25 a game. This year it's going to be different. It's going to be like it was in the finals. He's going to get 31.3 a game in my estimation. Where is he going to score a ton of points? Mark it down.
There's too many guys on the Warriors for him to score that many points. He had his lowest scoring season since his rookie year last year. Curry's got to get his. Klay's got to get his. I'm taking a guy in James Harden who had 29 points per game last year, and now he's got a guy who loves feeding him the ball in Chris Paul. This guy is just going to be a catch and shoot king this year. Chris Paul hasn't scored 20 in years. Now, he's only playing with one star, unlike KD, who's playing with multiple stars. Mark it down. James Harden is the favorite for this award in Vegas. He's taking it.
Great start. Second round, question 53 overall. What is this season's most anticipated milestone? Here we go.
The Washington Wizards are going to win 50 games for the first time in ever, because since they were named the Wizards 20 seasons ago, they haven't won 50 games. Actually, their franchise hasn't won 50 games since 1978-79. That's before you were born, Lee. That's a long ago. Actually, it wasn't, because you're old. That's right. Thank you for correcting me. 56 years, this franchise has only done it 5 times. The Wizards are going to do it.
I remember that season. It was a good season. LeBron James is going to become the 7th person to reach 30,000 points. Not only the 7th, the youngest by about a year. When he reaches that mark, by my prediction, January 23rd, the 46th game of the season, that's when LeBron is going to do it. Maybe he might wait till the next night when they're at home. The game is on the road on January 23rd, but the next game's at home. So he's going to do it in January.
All right, don't give me the schedule. We don't need the schedule.
That's what he's going to get.
Final round. It's a good battle here. Leave it all on the floor, guys. I want to know which player desperately needs a nickname. Here we go!
I'm looking forward to the Lonzo Ball era in LA, but let's get one thing straight. He needs a new nickname. He can't call himself Zoe. When I say Zoe, who do you think of?
Lonzo.
No, you don't. You think of the muscly, the big, the massive Alonzo morning from the Miami Heat.
Yeah.
His nickname is Zoe. Zoe is, that is the real Zoe. Lonzo Ball, get a new nickname, please. He's all about the brand. He knows how to do that.
Well, you're killing his brand because his Instagram handle is Zoe. LaMelo, his brother's Instagram handle is Mello. Leandro, their other brother, is named Jello on Instagram. You can't mess with Zoe. John Wall needs a new nickname. He's a two-name guy. You don't call him Wall. You don't call him John. You have to say both John and Wall together. It just doesn't flow. He's like a Jimmy Butler or a Zach Randolph two-name guy.
Heck of a battle. Heck of a battle. But in the end, you got to respect your elders. Leolis is the winner because he's old. There you go, old man.
Old man strength.
A good battle.
Hey now.
He's an old man.
Oh, boy.
Oh, man. I'll return with the WWE right after the break. Oh my goodness, look who it is, it's Tina!
Tina!
Hey, Tina.
Tina checking her fantasy team. Got a big draft coming up. She's looking for some sleepers, and we encourage you to do the same. NBA.com/fantasy. All right, let's check the Twitter poll results. We asked you, who's winning Rookie of the Year? We gave you three options and then the other, so you could go with whoever you want. Ben Simmons, though, takes it with 42%. A lot of votes for other. And then Lonzo there. 23%, Markelle Fultz coming in at 7%.
Anya Simon.
You didn't just pick Simmons because he's Australian, right?
No, I didn't, but it helps.
All right, coming up tomorrow, part 7 of our season preview series, we'll talk about the worst move of the offseason. We're going to build our dream dunk contest field for LA's midseason showcase. And who has the best handles in the league? Is it Kyrie, Curry, Crawford? Someone else we're forgetting. So
Lee Ellis pre-show.
Yeah. Lee, you really brought it today with specific facts, by the way.
I had to, man. I had to.
You said Kevin Durant's going to score 31.3 points per game.
Mark
and then
down.
You said LeBron is going to surpass 30,000 points in the 46th game
of the season. Yes.
Man.
Yes. Mark it down. January
20th. Stop saying mark it down.
Mark it down.
All right. We'll be back tomorrow for part, 7
That's
of our
right.
season preview series.
Thanks for joining us, folks. And remember, WrestleMania 7 will feature Hulk Hogan and Sergeant Slaughter.
Grace the night, people.